Unquestionable assumptions don't always lead people to taking up and defending logically absurd positions. No, if they are correct, then no such absurdities follow. But when the unquestionable assumptions are not correct, some form of conflict with evidence becomes inevitable at some point. For several thousand years, it was assumed that the Earth stood still at the center of the universe. This was not that unreasonable an assumption. We know what it feels like to move and doesn't feel like we're moving. Of course, what we feel is not movement, but acceleration. While I wouldn't stage the World Billiards Championship on board a cruise ship, it is possible to be moving quite rapidly, but smoothly, and so be unaware of your movement. Indeed, we are moving rapidly. The Earth is spinning on its axis at about 1,000 miles per hour, or, more appropriately, we are spinning at the rather pedestrian rate of 1 RPD, 1 revolution per day. Have you ever watched the minute hand of a clock move? That's herring around at a speed of 24 RPD. Even the apparently glacial speed of the hour hand is going twice as fast as we are, 2 RPD. So it's hardly surprising that it didn't occur to anybody that the Earth spins until somebody thought about it in a particularly open-minded way. Suddenly, the movements in the heavens began to make a lot more sense. Now there was an explanation for why Mars apparently decides to change direction in the sky and move backwards for a time. It was moving steadily all the time, and so were we, but Mars is describing a larger elliptical path than we are. No longer would we need unexplained just-so stories to describe the movements of the planets. Everything out there, and our planet as well, follow the same simple laws of motion. Well, they seem simple when some really bright people manage to understand them. Once we had relaxed the assumption of a fixed Earth, it became a lot easier to accept that the Sun wasn't stationary either, and now we accept that the Earth rotates on its axis, orbits about the Sun, and the entire solar system orbits the galactic center, and the entire galaxy isn't stationary either. Freeing yourself from an imagination-limiting assumption makes it possible to appreciate reality, and it often leads to the demolition of structures which were put in place to explain anomalies that were never actually anomalies at all. Today we have numerous assumptions which hem in our quest for the truth and require us to build absurd structures to our theories in the way that astronomers used to describe the mysterious epicycles which caused the retrograde motion of Mars and Venus. We assume that all men are equal. This is a completely absurd notion if you allow yourself to think about it freely without listening to your internal censor. All our experience tells us that people differ and vary. If you are of below average intelligence, you might not appreciate just how much intelligence varies because you're not smart enough to realize what smart is. I think I am smart enough to appreciate the differences between stupid people and me, and between me and significantly smarter people. But I think it will be necessary to be as smart as the smarter people are in order to appreciate the differences between the significantly smarter than average and the stupendously intelligent. A lot of stupid people are in a similar position to a child looking up into a tree and appreciating that a leaf is out of reach and so is the moon and deducing that the moon is maybe a little bit higher than the tree or maybe about the same. I suppose the word deducing there is a bit of a stretch. It's more of a guess, I reckon. We all know that people vary enormously, from those who struggle to muster the enthusiasm to scratch their arse to those who are in danger of starving to death as they try to finish their fourth symphony before they reach 21. So how on earth can we believe that in some way they are all equal? It's a stupid idea, a dangerous idea. Treating people as if they were equal, as if their lives were of equal value, is simply a way that we can reduce conflict. We assume a fictional or notional equality rather than have a constant battle to prove who is superior. But we need to accept this idea for what it is and not try to base our entire world upon a lie. People are not all the same. They are not equal in intelligence any more than they are equal in height. They are not equal in moral strength any more than they are equal in weight. Nothing in nature ever is, was, or will be equal. Nature doesn't do equal, and in all probability, nature can't do equal. Trying to prop up your worldview with conspiracy theories such as the patriarchy and institutional racism will only lead to layering more lies and distortions on top of your ill-founded assumptions. Reality is often offensive and rarely politically correct. Again, reality doesn't and cannot care. In reality, different populations are different, usually similar, but always a little bit different. There is no mechanism or requirement for equality between groups, such as nations, classes, or races. If you take a shuffled pack of cards and deal out 10 cards, and then another 10 cards, do you expect that each pile of 10 cards will have the same number of kings, the same number of black cards, and the same total number of heart symbols? Unless you are watching a magician who is deliberately manipulating things, you'd be a fool to expect such a thing. That is not how reality works. So why do we assume that the races and the sexes are and must be equal? It is an absurd assumption. A sensible assumption is that they will be similar and overlapping in scores. It is a sensible assumption because it fits with our experience. We all know women who are smarter than the average man, and white people who would probably need quite a bit of whipping before they picked up the basics of cotton picking. Similar and overlapping is a sensible assumption backed up by experience. Identical is an absurd assumption. Women don't earn as much money over a lifetime as do men. This is because women make different choices and different compromises. Men are far more likely to respond to the incentive of higher pay to do a dirty, dangerous, or simply unglamorous job. There is no sewer worker Barbie doll, and not even a carpet fitter or van driver Barbie doll either. Women want glamorous jobs, and failing that, they want jobs that are safe and not dirty. A woman is far more likely to choose to do a near minimum wage office or shop job rather than something which involves risk, a lot of manual effort, unsocial hours, or learning something a bit technical. Women also do fewer hours per week and fewer years per lifetime because they put directly caring for their children ahead of providing for them financially. As a result, men earn more than women when averaged over their lifetimes, and this is nothing to do with how repressed they are. In societies where women have the freest choices, women choose more typically female jobs and are less likely to study mathematics or engineering than are women in what you might think were more patriarchal societies. If you give women the choice, they don't choose to be shorter men, perhaps with longer hair. They choose to be who they feel they are. Just as the sexes are not the same and interchangeable, neither are races or ethnic groups. It is madness to regard different outcomes between different races as being proof of invisible, systemic, or unconscious racism. If you can't see what is racist about asking people to demonstrate their skills or judgment, can you at least consider the possibility that the reason the groups did not perform equally was that they did not have equal abilities? Why is that thought so unthinkable? It was said that Sherlock Holmes would eliminate the impossible, and then whatever remained, however unlikely, must be the truth. It seems that today liberals, who are the vast majority of those with power and influence, eliminate that which is unthinkable, and then whatever remains, however preposterous and insane, must be the truth. Now there's your problem. You're eliminating the unthinkable when you should instead be eliminating the untrue. It is preposterous to imagine hidden systemic oppression against women and ethnic minorities, which somehow results in the pattern you would predict if the groups were in fact not equal. Which is more likely, that you can't put your finger on racism and the racist when looking directly at them, but they must be there somehow, or that your base assumptions, which you have never questioned, are in error? Why do the liberal left always require that other people to question and change their assumptions when they never question their own? Indeed, they consider such a suggestion to be the height of immorality. Me? Question my assumptions? How very dare you? Women don't have the same aspirations as do men. Why would you expect them to end up in the same place? Why would you then assume that the only reason that the women didn't end up in the same place as the men was because the men ganged up on the women secretly, leaving no traces anywhere of their conspiracy meeting or their underhand actions? Why would you then expect your conspiracy theories to be treated as if they were an academic discipline with equal status to physics? We are living in a clown world in which the dominant religion is liberalism and the church of universal equality. The belief in the fundamental equality of all people is far more dangerous to our worldview and our policy decisions than the idea of a fixed, immovable, and flat earth. We need to be quite clear, equality is a social construct. It is simply a socially useful lie. We pretend that everybody is the same or equal in some way, when in reality there is nothing equal in nature at all. But this lie is only useful to a very limited degree. It is useful as the basis for laws, so that we don't arbitrarily assign people to inferior or superior status based on birth or the possession of some marker. If we are honest to ourselves, we can see the reality that some people are simply better in almost every aspect. There are men who are taller than average, who are also more handsome, faster at running and driving and swimming and solving crossword puzzles and anything else you care to mention. And these men are often better at concentrating and better at deferring gratification and resisting temptation to commit crimes or to cheat on their partners, friends, or their group or nation. Similarly, there are men who are short, fat, ugly, slow, dim, lazy, and morally reprehensible too. What is true of individuals is also true, to some extent, of groups. There is no magical force which redistributes traits so that all groups come out equal overall. No. African pygmies are shorter, lower in intelligence, and have life histories which are much faster than other races, such that their women have menopause at an age when a quarter or so of Western Europeans or East Asians are still virgins. Pretending that all people are the same or equal in reality is going to be damaging. There are differences between individuals and groups, and these differences are not caused by bullying, bad childhoods, or systematic oppression. People vary. Diversity is not our greatest strength as a nation or species. It is a challenge that we have to grapple with. Little Timmy is not retarded. He's not a bit slow at learning. He will not catch up if we keep him in school a little longer or give him a bit of one-on-one tuition. He's incapable of attaining anything close to average intellectual development. For him, books will only ever be for colouring in or sticking in pictures that smarter people have created. We all know this stuff on some level. We know that some people are more attractive, some people are stronger, some people are better at fighting, and some people are capable of making their teachers look stupid, lazy, and uncreative. Inequality and the diversity of human capacities is the elephant in the room, and our leaders of politics and society have been studiously ignoring it and decrying as moral inferiors those who have pointed out the enormous pachyderm and the stuff we've all been treading in.